So there's lots to eat. You just have to snap out of that that routine that you're in and get ready to be bored for a little while until you start getting creative again. And then once you get creative, then there's no limit. You know, I fix a lot of great meals now, but most people just go into shock.
So what then do you feed animals? Let's kind of roll that off from what humans eat to what you feed animals or what you recommend for pet owners.
Well, for pet owners, really, and here's the myth buster, you know, is that the best thing for pets to eat is table food, to use a term, but of course, excluding 70 to 80% of what we eat. Veterinarians got into telling people no table food because they just knew that table food, you know, when you think of table food, then you're thinking of breadcrumbs and cheese and the things that you left on your plate that you decided that you didn't want to eat and you give that to your dog, you know, the fat off of the steak, you know, and all of those things. No wonder we would have dogs have digestive upsets. You're giving them whatever you decided that you didn't want to eat. But of course, dogs are carnivores, as you pointed out so accurately. And so are cats. That's why the picture on my website, I was glad to find, is just a dog and a cat, you know, up on a table looking at this plate of burgers, you know, and that pretty much says it all. That's what they should be eating. Cats are almost strict carnivores. They would get a little vegetation from eating the intestinal tract of their little herbivorous victims. But dogs are scavengers by nature. They would eat meat. They would eat eggs. They would find some rotten fruit or rotten vegetable somewhere. They would eat animal scat. You know, they would eat a lot of different things. But basically, they can do very well on meat. There are some people who are purists who I used to work with actually on some radio shows that they say that dogs are strict carnivores. And there's some truth in that. The oldest dog I have at my practice right now is a 22-year-old Chihuahua that's eaten nothing but boiled chicken and water his entire life. Nothing but. No fruits, no vegetables, no nothing. I went down the list with him to the point of being annoying, and he told me, no, he eats nothing but boiled chicken and water, nothing else. And the dog was in perfect general health. He came in for a rabies shot. Couldn't find anything wrong with him. But today, dogs don't live in natural environments. They live in polluted environments. And you and I know that the solution to pollution are antioxidants. And where are dogs and cats going to get antioxidants? They're going to get them from the same place we are, from fruits and vegetables and supplements like vitamin C, vitamin E, and grapeseed extract. And so we can't be purists because dogs are not living in pure environments anymore, so we really need to give them a source of antioxidants. And dogs die of a much, much higher rate of cancer than humans do, and so they're obviously suffering dismally from a lack of antioxidants. And when you look at the label of dog food, my gosh, everything, you know, makes perfectly good sense. And so the bottom line is the healthiest diet for a dog is a home-prepared diet of what we were just talking about, meat, eggs, fruits, vegetables, and they would thrive on that. In lieu of that, most people are not willing to do that. Sadly, you know, 98% of my clients are not going to cook for their dogs, despite the fact that many of them say they love their dog more than their spouse. you'll see the bumper sticker around that says "Lost husband and the dog, reward for the dog." and actually, that's kind of tongue in cheek, but you know, there's a tremendous amount of truth in that. A lot of these people, you know, the point's made, I guess. But on the other hand, they're not going to, you know, I say, you know, the best thing to do is cook for your dog. What? I'm not going to cook for my dog. You know, and so you say, okay, then the best thing for you to do, here's a list of dog foods on my website, and I give them a handout that has an abbreviated list. These are dog foods that don't contain any of what I call the big four. We want to avoid all gluten, which is wheat, barley, and rye, all dairy products, including milk, cheese, and I go down the list of them for them. All soy and all corn. And so that leaves you with either a rice-based food or a potato-based food. And there's a number of both of those out there. Most of them are going to contain one of the big four, so you have to read all labels. But one of the prominent people that's taken this route is Mr. Dick Van Patten. People remember him from Eight is Enough. He's been a great voice in the wilderness. He's very much into dog food. Been raising golden retrievers and showing them, I guess, for a long time. And he came out with a line of foods called Natural Balance, which are potato and or sweet potato based. And plus, they also have novel proteins like venison and bison and salmon and duck for those dogs who have developed severe secondary food allergies, which we know are very, very, very common with people with food intolerance, like gluten intolerance. And so he's come out with a full line of dog food, and I carry him in my hospital because I want to be able to give somebody a bag of something and say, I want you to stop what you're feeding day before yesterday, and I want you to feed this now. You know, and they walk out with the food, and it's really been great. But there's rice-based foods out there too. There's also commercially prepared raw foods or whole foods that people can buy at grocery stores. I mean, not at grocery stores, but at pet shops. And so there's a big movement in veterinary medicine. Although I plan to do a formal big push here in the next month or two to try to make a major, you know, awareness of this situation, because we're in an interesting place in veterinary medicine right now. You walk into a pet shop, a very prominent one, the biggest one in the country, and you'll find these bags over here that prominently say on the bag they're proud to say no wheat, no soy, or no corn, and then you look at the bag next to it, and those are the first three ingredients.
Right.
And so they know it, but they don't know it. And so we're on the verge of a major revolution, and I'm just afraid, you know, the pet food industry is not going to change until we force them to, just like other things. And in their defense, they just don't know what you and I know. You know, I have written some interesting articles on the Internet, one of which that got a lot of attention, called Is the Pet Food Industry in the Business of Population Control? Now, it sounds like a conspiracy theory paper, but it's not. It is a description of what just you and I have been talking about all this time, you know, what we've been talking about, and the conclusion I leave up to the reader. Now, okay, if I tell you all of this, and like you so accurately said, there's no dog is going to be wandering through a man-made, man-cultivated field of corn or wheat or barley, and he's not going to eat it even if he does, and there's no cow on earth that's going to let a cow or a cat or a dog come up and start suckling on it. Okay, and they're not going to go to Asia and dig up soy under the ground somewhere. Okay, so what are we doing putting all of these things in dog food? And when you understand the harm they're doing and what we know that they're doing to these dogs, then what are they doing? Do they not know this, or do they not care?